Okay, so nigga, last time we started with the C++ standard library, and there will be many useful classes in there for data structures and functions for algorithms. There's just so much in there that you can just write the big book about it, and we'll spend 2 hours on it. So I tell you some important things, and the rest you look up in manuals, you just look up in the standard, in textbooks, play with it, figure out. The first class that we've already seen is the string class. There's a string class and there's the white character string class, the W string class. The string class can store any 8-bit character, so the word hello or English or whatever. The white character string is if you use Unicode characters for Chinese text, Arabic text, Japanese text. And I think Lei can read that word, although it's in Japanese and not in Chinese. The string class has many members. You can resize a string, you can count substrings, you can find substrings, replace substrings, erase substrings, and so on. The best thing is if you need to manipulate a string, look at the reference documentation for the string class and you'll find many useful parts in it. I will not discuss this further and it will not be part of the exam. What will be needed is the pair template, and the pair is a very simple but useful class. A pair is two things. So the class pair consists of two members, first and second. The first one is called first, the second one is called second, and it is templated on the type of those two members. What is useful? One simple example, what's useful is if you have a function that should return two values, then you just return a pair. But now we go to something more complex, namely data structures in C++. We look at the array type classes, linked lists, trees, queues, and stacks. And so on. And most of you will have heard about data structure already. Is there somebody here who's never heard about the linked list or about the tree? You've never heard about it? Okay, I'll tell you a bit about it first. An array or vector, this is a consecutive range in memory. Like the built-in C array, just one value after the other. Stored, why is it useful? It's useful because access is fast. If I know the starting address, then I can calculate the address of any entry. If I need to access the ith element, then just the address is the starting address plus the offset I, and that's it. So I can simply access it very quickly. It is constant time to find it. It's also fast because it is a contiguous sequence in memory, so we profit from cache effects. If we go through it sequentially, then we first read the first element, but the machine already loads a full cache line of 64 bytes into the cache. So when I then want to access the next one, it's already in the cache and it's fast. Searching can be done in a binary search. We learn that later. That is log n. Insertion and removal at the end is the amortized constant time. In the middle somewhere it's n. Why is that? If I have the vector A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, and I want to insert the X between the D and the E, I have to get a new array that's longer, and then I have to move the E, F, G, and H. I have to move half of it backwards. And that's why the complexity to insert at the random location is linear. Same for the removal. I need to move the other values around that is again nicely consecutively in memory. So insertion and removal is slow. But what we learned last time is that the insertion at the end can be fast if I allocate more elements than I need. So to store a vector or an array, if I distinguish between the capacity and the size, where the capacity is the number of elements that are allocated, and the size is the number I actually use, then I can do the removal at the end in constant time. It's simple. I have the A, B, C, D, E, F. I remove the F, I just change the size to 5, and that's it. I don't change the memory that I allocated. And for the insertion, once it's full, I double the size, and then the next 4 can be inserted for free. So that way you get the insertion at the end and the removal at the end in constant time. Now there's also the DEC data structure. That's a double-ended queue that looks like an array. And the features are basically that access to a place is fast, insertion at the end is constant time, and insertion at the beginning or removal at the beginning is also constant time. We need that for a queue, for example, where I insert at the end and where I remove at the start. Can you think about a way how you would implement such a thing? With fast random access, fast insertion at the end, that's like a vector, but also fast insertion at the beginning. Does anybody have an idea? We can take this vector. And what did we do when we wanted to insert at the end? We just grow it to the end. How about if we also add some buffer at the beginning? Let's take also some spare elements at the start. Then we can easily insert at the beginning, and once we fill it up, we just get more at the start. And when we remove, then we just remove. Would that work? Yes, you say yes. Who's for no? Raise your hands. Why doesn't it work?
Because once you have a full buffer, you need to make a new buffer at the start, you need to copy the whole array.
Okay, so once it's full, you mean once you go to the end, when you fill it up, then you have to copy it again like here. You copy it, and then you have more spare parts.
The binary search still works,
yes, because I look from the beginning to the end of the allocated part, because I need to store which part is used. First. Random access still works. What if I always insert at the end and always remove at the beginning? Then it just gets more and more and more spare parts at the start, and it just fills up with lots of spare parts, and I never get rid of them. So then at least sometimes you have to clean up. Or one might implement it by taking this and breaking it into segments of a fixed size, million elements. And then once the first million ones have been empty, I just throw it away. So one can think of ways of how one can implement it efficiently. But the nice thing about C++ is that the standard requires that every compiler vendor already gives you a nice, fast implementation of a DEC. You don't have to think about it, because it has to be there with your compiler. It's now the problem of the compiler vendor to give you a nice one. Then a stack data structure, we all know, it's just we stack things, and whatever we put on as the last is the one that goes off the first. So we put on top, and we remove from the top. What goes in last gets out first. And I want to be able to put things in constant time, remove things in constant time, and I want to be able to access the top element. And the other one that's similar is a queue data structure, but the queue is I put things in at the back, and the one in front goes out first. So it's the first one in will be the first one out. This means you put it in at the back and you remove at the front. And this is why here you need a DAG data structure to make it fast. You want something where you insert at the back always and you always remove at the front. And you want to see who's the first and who's the last in the queue. That should be fast. Then there's another data structure that I like or that I would like in the Mensa. That's the priority queue data structure. That's a queue where the first one in is the first one out, but professors always come before the students. So where you take out the one that has that came in first, but with the highest priority first. First professors, then assistants, then students, then visitors. How would you implement that? This is now even harder than a deck, because you want it still to be fast. The good news will be you don't have to think about it because the thing will just be there in the standard and you can use it. Linked lists. There was someone who didn't know what a linked list was. A linked list is that I don't allocate the elements contiguously, but each element gets allocated separately in memory. And the sequence of how I go from one to the other is through pointers. So I have the pointer to the first element, then the first element has a pointer to the next one, and to the next one, and the next one, and the next one. To show why it's interesting, and let me just quickly sketch why this is useful for those who haven't seen it yet. The reason why it's useful is if you have such a linked list data structure, where you start here, and this points to the next one, and always a point to the next element, which is somewhere in memory. If you now want to insert another one, let's say I want to insert another one here. In the vector, I had to copy all the rest one over. And that takes time, order n, when n is the size. For the linked list, I just have to allocate the new entry in memory. And all I have to do is I have to change the pointers. Just have to set a new pointer here and a pointer here. So the time is constant, O1, for the insertion. If you want to remove something, let's say I want to remove this one here, the only thing you have to do is have to delete the entry and then have to make a new set the pointer to point to there. Again, constant time. So the advantage is that that random insertion and random removal is fast, but finding an element is slow, because if you want to go to the 10th element, I have to start from the start, I have to go to the second, or the third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seven, eight, nine, ten. So the access to the nth element takes n steps. Access is linear. So searching is also linear time because I have to go through the whole list step by step by step by step. It can't be faster. And it also does not profit from cache effects. So this is useful if you often want to insert or remove at a random location. Now let me ask you for the Panda model. You should now implement the population. Which data structure do you use, a vector or a list? Or something else. So who's for vector? One. Who's for list? Many? Who's for something else? Okay. You pick what you want, you code it, and we'll discuss it later. So it will be list for most. That's good. That's also what I will propose today. And in a couple of weeks, we'll change it. If somebody already has an idea how to change it, you may do so. Now, there's another data structure that we might consider using, but I don't think it's too useful here. And there's a tree data structure. That is something that is this kind of in between a list and a vector. The array needed order n operation for the insertion and removal at an arbitrary point, but random access was fast. Searching when it was sorted was also fast because you can just do a binary search. The list is fast for inserting, but finding something is slow because I have to go through it. With a tree, if you have sorted data, then you can have fast finding and fast insertion and removal. And the way it goes is you build up a tree where you have a root and then branches going out, the children, and you sort them so that the branch to the left has the smaller values and the branch to the right has the larger values. So in the simple binary tree here, there are two children. There might be more in the more complex tree. So now we have the M in the middle, then the D goes to the left and the S to the right, and we can grow it bigger. There's the root up there, there's a big branch down here, and at the end, those we call the leaves. And always when you go to the left, it gets smaller, to the right, it gets bigger. The S, for example, is bigger than the M, so it's to the right here. And next, I insert the N. N is bigger than M, so it goes to the right. But then the N is smaller than the S, and so it goes to the left, and that's where it is. So you just go through it. If what you look for is smaller, you go to the left. If it's bigger, you go to the right. And now at the first level, you store one element, the next two, four, eight, and so on. So when the height is N, then you can store 2 to the N minus 1 elements. And thus, but to find it, you only have to go down the height of the tree. So the time to find or to insert the element is the logarithm of the number of elements that you can store inside the tree. But we have to be careful. The tree has to be balanced. Let's build up a tree in a stupid way. We start with A, and A is the root. Now we put in B. B is to the right, so it goes here, and then we put in C, D, E, F, and so on. You see we build up basically a linked list. Because always, yes, the F is bigger than the E, so it goes there, and we go to the G, and we go to the H, and so on. And we built up this horribly stupid tree where it takes linear time to find it. This is not how we want to store a tree. So we can't just build it up by going where it should be and then it is, but we need to build a smarter tree data structure where it's always nicely balanced, where it's nicely filled in and a nice, beautiful, balanced tree and not this stick version of a tree. Now, how do you implement a tree that is self-balancing, that always when you insert things, it rearranges itself to be nicely balanced? You can buy thick textbooks about that or listen to a full lecture of 4 hours a week on just on tree data structures. And they're interesting. There are many tree data structures that are really useful. But for most purposes, it's enough if C++ provides you with tree data structures that you can use. So for the most common applications, the trees that you need will be there in the standard. You don't have to care about it. You just have to know how to use them. So, and there will be 4 different types of trees in it. There's the set data structure, and the set is just a tree, like here, of numbers or of letters or words. Something that is sorted. But in this set, each element can appear only once. The word hello, for example, can appear only once in it because you don't have multiple entries. Like here in this tree, we also had every letter only once. That's the set data structure in C++. The multi-set data structure allows you to have multiple copies of the same element in it. There might be 5 A's in the tree. And then there will be a map data structure and the multi-map. The map data structure that we learn will be just a phone book. There's a key, the name, and then a value, the phone number. But we'll get to details of this later. And now we want to discuss the data structures that are in the standard. They're called the containers. And they're typically templated on the type of the element. There's a vector of types T, there's a list of type T, and a set, and so on. In order to use such a container with your data structure, the type has to have a default constructor, it has to be assignable, and it has to be copy the constructible. Why do you need to make copies? Simply, when I take a vector and I resize it, I might have to copy over all the elements. And the copy constructor, it's important that it makes an identical copy. You should not be smart and think, hey, in the Panda model, when I clone a genome, then there are mutations. So I could be smart and I could make a copy constructor that mutates the genome. That's not a good idea. Because when you have the vector of genomes, then just when you resize it, it shouldn't cause mutations. So don't be so smart. The copy constructor always has to make identical copies. But now, how do we go through an array or a vector? How do we go through a linked list? And there we have a problem that I want to discuss with you. And the problem is that how I traverse a data structure depends on the specific data structure. Let's, on the left, look at an array. We allocate an array here, then we can just go through it just from 0 to n, and we print out the nth element. Or we can do it with pointers, and with pointers, I set the pointer to the start of the array, check as long as the pointer is not equal to the start plus the size, I print the value with star p, and then I increment the pointer. So just go through it, and I just increment the pointer by 1, and I print out each element. In a linked list, it's different. First of all, we don't have the element-wise access to a random element. This operator I will not have. I can in principle do it, but will not have it because it will never be efficient. In the linked list, I have to go through it and count through it. So we don't implement things that are not efficient. Because people might just be tempted and use it. And it's just a waste of their time and my time if we code it. So in a list, let's here make such a list. The data structure, the list is just a pointer to the first node. And the node contains a value and a pointer to the next one. So here I have the value and the pointer to the next node. How would I go through that list? I need a pointer to nodes. Here, that's my node pointer p. I start with the first one. Then to print the value, I don't use star p, but I use p error value because I want to print that value element of my node. And then to go to the next element, I don't just do plus plus p, but I have to say p is equal to p arrow next, because I have to take the pointer that points to the next one. And that way go through it. So here, that's a loop where I have a node, that should be node, not mode, pointer p equal l dot first, I print the value p arrow value, go to the next one, and the end I mark by the last pointer being zero. So that's how I end up here. Any questions about this? Any problem with this? I see a huge problem here. I mean, the problem I see is that each data structure needs a different way of going through it. Next, I go a deck, and if I have to do the deck in segments that are split up, then I have to know exactly how is it implemented. In bunches of 1,000, I have to know which one comes after which. A tree, how do I go through a tree? I have to know exactly how it's stored, and I have to then go in the right way through the tree, up and down the tree. And this is just for printing values. Now the issue is I want to have many algorithms, finding something, copying, merging, transforming, accumulating, on many data structures. I have to write them all for each of the algorithms, the copy, the merge, the transform, and so on. I have to write it for all data structures. So when I have n algorithms and m data structures, I need to write n times m different codes. That's bad. And basically, they all do the same thing, just on a different data structure. Do the finding in a vector, the finding in a list, the finding in a deck, the finding in a set, in a map, in a C array, and so on. Can we change that? Can we change the n times m into n plus m? So that when I add an algorithm, I write it only once, and it will work for all data structures. When I write a new data structure, I have to only do one thing, namely write the data structure, and not re-implement 100 algorithms for my new data structure. And the answer is yes, but we have to think a way of abstracting the access to the elements. And the basic idea is, what I want to do is I want to write the way how I go through the data structures in exactly the same way, no matter what the data structure is. So I want to use one syntax for printing all elements, no matter what the data structure is. When we look here at the array, we had a pointer that we set to something. Then we do some check on the pointer, and then we do something to go to the next value, that's the plus plus, and then we print something with star p. In the list, we set some pointer to something, we do some check for the end, we do something to go to the next step, and we do something to print the value. And I want to use the same syntax. Let me use a syntax that is just like for the array. And the thing with which I go through it, I will call an iterator. Something with which I just iterate from one to the next. And the first one is p equals something. I just want to write something like p equal a dot begin. For the end test, which here was a plus size, which there was zero, I just want to check for an end. So I want to write something like p not equal a dot end. Going to the next element, they want to use a very simple notation, namely just plus plus, like for pointer. And for accessing the element, I just want to use the star operator, star p. I want to use the same for the array and for the list. Can I do that? Can I go to the next one with a plus plus? No, because it's p arrow value. But I can if I implement a new class, a new type that does it. So here I just need to implement a new class where when I do plus plus p, what it actually does is p equal p arrow next. I need to just dress it up in some class. So here's how we would do it for the array class. How do I go through it? Through an array, I go through it with a pointer. So here we have a type, array of t colon colon iterator, that is just a pointer to go through an array. So all the array class has to have, it has to have this iterator type member, and I add a type def t star iterator. The iterator is just a pointer. Now this is just the pointer. So because here I had a t star p, and then I initialize it with, for the array, I needed to initialize it with the pointer to the start of my data, a.p. But the way I want to write it is, I want to write it as a.begin. So I just need the member function begin that returns the pointer p. You have it here. Iterator begin, the function just returns p. What was the end of it? The end test was p not equal a.p plus a.size. I want to replace that by the syntax a.end. What do I have to do to make it happen? I need an end function that just returns p plus size. The not equal for pointers is good enough. For the pointer, the plus plus is good enough. It goes to the next one. And the star p, that's the same. That just works since it's a pointer. So it was easy to make this work for the array, because all we did is we called the pointer iterator, that was a type def, and we had two functions, begin and end, that give us the values where I start and where I end. What's also so important here to mention is that the end here is, once I reach the end, then I stop. So the end value is one past the last element in the array. It's the first iterator that is past the end. Once I reach there, then I stop. Now, the linked list. Here it's a bit harder. In the linked list, I also want to do an iterator. I want to do a begin and an end, and I want to do a not equal and a plus plus and a star p. But what it did was different, right? For the linked list, going to the next element is p equal p arrow next. It's not just the plus plus on the pointer. And so we now have to implement a class that acts like a pointer, but that actually traverses the linked list. And you call the class in this case node iterator. And this class now should work like a pointer, but actually go through the list. So what does it need? It needs a constructor that takes a pointer and they store the pointer somewhere. That's easy. But then I need a plus plus operator so that I can type plus plus p. But the plus plus should take the pointer to the next one. It should do, just when you look back here at the iteration, p equal p arrow next, that should be replaced by plus plus p. So plus plus p should set p to p arrow next. And that's what we do here. The plus plus operator says p equal p arrow next. To access the element, I want to use star p. But the way it's accessed is p arrow value. So operator star just returns p arrow value. If I want to get the pointer address, I want to use the arrow operator that just returns me the address of p arrow value. And the last thing I need is a not equal operator. So let me implement a not equal operator that compares two node iterators and it compares the value of the pointer that I store. So now this class is basically just, it stores a pointer and I dress it up by making the operator plus plus go to the next element of the list. And the operator star access the next value in the access the value of the element here. And that way we have the iterator. And in my list class, I'm now doing a type def that iterator is this node iterator type for the list. Now this code here works. The list of t colon colon iterator, p, that's my iterator, equal L dot begin. L dot begin is just the iterator to the first one. Because if you look back at how we did it manually, we set it to the pointer to the first element. And the last element was the check that whether it's zero, because the last one, back here, after the last one, I just point to zero, because it's invalid. There's nothing else coming. And so we have a member function begin in the list that returns an iterator pointing to the first one. And that's the invalid one at the end, that's an iterator where the pointer is zero. And with this type def and these two member functions and the iterator class, now this same code here allows me to just iterate through the linked list with the same syntax that I used to iterate through the array. The list iterator p equal l dot begin, so it initializes the pointer in here with the first element. I check p not equal l dot end, I check for zero. I printed star p, but star p accesses p error value, just what I want. Then I do the plus plus, and the plus plus takes me to the next element. I've now written a class that acts like a pointer, but actually goes through a linked list. Now I can do the same to go through a stack, through a deck, through a tree, and so on. And I make your life much easier if every data structure implements such an iterator. That's a way of going sequentially through the data structure. Then I can implement functions like printing in the same way, no matter what the data structure is. So the iterators have the same functionality as pointers. They look like pointers. I can look at differences. I can go plus plus. I can go up. With minus minus, I go down. With star, I get the value. But it's a generalization of the pointer concept because it works with any data structure. When you look at the standard, you will find many different types of iterators. You will find forward iterators. These are ones that just move forward through a sequence. The backward iterators that just go backwards, that just do minus minus. The standard mentions bidirectional iterators that can do plus plus and minus minus. The standard mentions input iterators. An input iterator is one from which you can read the value. Also mentions output iterators, those are the ones you can write to. And then there are const versions. A const iterator is one where you can access the value, but you can't really modify it. That doesn't make sense for an output iterator. So now, let's look at containers. And for that, I want to show you things from the standard. We gave you your handouts about the standard and the section of the standard about containers. These are 49 pages. Those 49 pages contain all you have to know about the data structures in the standard, and I want to look through a little bit with you so that you learn how to read the standard. Who is already very skilled in standard Ds, in C++ standard Ds? Have you looked at the standard yet? It's a big 800-page document. Here we start at page 459. And first, it shows you that there are certain headers here. There are headers, deck, list, queue, stack, vector, map, set, and bit set, the bit set we used already. And down there, it first explains what is a container. Here you see containers are objects that store other objects. That makes sense. They control the allocation and deallocation, they better do, of these objects through constructors, destructors, insert and erase operation, then complexity and so on. And the type inside has to be assignable. We already had the assignable concept. Assignable is T equal U is what I have to write. The return type should be referenced to T, and the post condition is that they are equivalent. And then here, there are now a couple of pages about the container requirements. This gives you the concepts that every container in the standard models. Like it tells you, there's the expression x colon colon value type, and that's the type T. So every container has a type member value type, and our array also had that. Remember, we had type def T value type in there. And there's a type, and the type should be assignable. That was the one condition. Then there was a reference and a const reference type. We had that already in the array class. Then there's an iterator, which we just mentioned. There's also a const iterator. The const iterator is the version with which you can go through a const sequence, one that lets you read but not write. There's a difference type. The difference type is a signed integral type that lets you store the difference between two iterators. What type should you use? Should you use a short or an int or a long? If you don't know with this, the difference type is always the appropriate type. There's also a size type. That's the appropriate integer to store the size of even the biggest possible container that you can allocate on your machine. That's the size type member. And then it lists here in a very compact way all of the operations that you can do. What is XU? That's the default constructor. And there's a post condition that the size is zero. The default constructor container should be empty. There's another version of the default constructor. There's a copy constructor. And the copy constructor has this post condition that the container is equal to its copy. And the time complexity is linear, it's ON. So the copy should not spend more time than linear in the size. Then we have the destructor. And the destructor destroys all the elements and then allocates the memory. Begin and end function that return the iterators. We had that just now. Operators equal and not equal to compare. And the function swap that swaps to the containers. And then there's an assignment. After the assignment, the two are the same. There's a size function that gives you the current size. There's max size that gives you the largest possible size you could allocate. There is a function empty that checks whether the container is empty. And then there are less than, greater than, less than equal, and greater than equal functions. So that's what all of the containers have. The vectors, the trees, the lists, the queues and the stacks and so on. And then we get to more in the standard. There's also a reversible container. A reversible one is where you can not only go forward, but you can also start at the end and go backwards through it. There's the reverse iterator. That is one that starts at the last element, and when you do plus plus, it goes backwards until it reaches the start. There's an R begin and an R end. Those things where you can also go backwards. And then it starts, as it does next, it has the sequences. And sequences are the linear sequences that have a linear ordering. That's the vector and the deck and the list. And then it goes on for a few dozen pages about sequences. And then it goes on about the trees. And this basically contains in 49 pages all that you have to know about all of the data structures. Use that as reference material Don't learn it by heart for the exam. I will not ask what is clause 23.243 of the standard. So now here, let's make a short break, 10 minutes, and then I will show you things about the data structures that will be useful for your homework works and projects. So now you can look further and you can find that there are just many, many, many different functions that those containers need to have. This is written in a very compact way because this is a document that's the reference for people writing a compiler so that they implement it in the correct way. This is useful to look up something like how was this spelled exactly. It's not really useful as a textbook. So I'm going to show you some things that you need to know and how it's used. For the sequences, so the vector, the deck, and the list, there's a constructor. The default one gives you the empty one. If you pass a size n, then it gives you a container with n elements. If you pass n and some value x, then it gives you one with n elements that are all the value x. Then there's a copy constructor. And finally, there's a special constructor that takes two iterators called first and last. What this does is it takes the one sequence specified by two iterators, could be begin and end, or it could be begin and begin plus 5 or something, and copies that over and builds the new container from that range of values. That is useful if you want to copy, for example, a list to a vector. Let's assume we have a list of doubles here, L, which you then fill in. And then in the end, we want to copy that list to a vector. Now we have here a constructor for a vector of doubles. And we initialize it with the two iterators L begin and L end. And then the range of values specified by the iterators so it gets copied over into the vector when it's constructed. For the vector in the deck, you can also have the access directly, the subscript operator. And there's also an add function. The add function checks whether the value is actually in the range, so whether k is less than the size. The subscript operator doesn't check when you pass the index that is out of range, the code might just crash. And then front and back give you access to the first element and the last element in the container. This is not implemented for a list, and the reason why it's not implemented for a list is that it's inefficient for a list, so it's just not implemented. To insert at the beginning and end, there's the function pushback that inserts one element at the end, and the function popback that removes the last element. And for the list and the deck, where it's efficient to insert at the beginning, there's also a push front that inserts a new value as the first element, and a pop front that removes the first element. If you want to insert or erase anywhere in the sequence, then you have to specify the location by an iterator. And there I might have to sketch something to make that clear. So let us sketch an array here. A, B, C, D, E, F. And now let me assume I want to insert something here between the C and D. I want to insert an X here. The way I do that is I call the function insert, and I pass it an iterator to the location where it should be inserted. And the question is now, should I pass it the iterator to the element after which it should be inserted or to the element before which it should be inserted. It might seem natural that I give it the location after which it should be inserted. But then, you see, if I then point to the A, which is the beginning, and I insert afterwards, then the X gets inserted after the A. But I also want to be able to insert something before the first element. And so the iterator P that I pass here is an iterator to the element before which it should be inserted. So here, if you want to insert it before the D, I pass it as P, the iterator pointing to the element D. Because that way, if I use the iterator begin, then it inserts it before the A. So this here is, would be begin. And it also works to insert at the end, because the end one is the one that's past the end. So I pass it the iterator before which it will be inserted. Then I can also call the insert and tell it to insert n elements of X. Or I can tell it to insert a whole range of values that I specify by to iterate from some other container. There's also erase that takes an iterator. The erase here would just delete the D. If I call erase and I pass the iterator to D and end, then it erases everything from D to the end. If you want to erase everything, then I just call the function clear. For vectors, we have a resize that we know from the array class, but there's also a reserve function. Remember, for the vector, we had memory allocated that might have been more than we need. What is allocated is called the capacity. So there's the function, the capacity here, that tells me how much is currently allocated. And there's a function resize that changes the size and function size to give the size. The function reserve can be used to allocate enough memory. Like if you want to insert a million elements and you know it's a million, then you can just first reserve memory for a million elements and then resize it when you need it. We also have an assignment, just the assignment operators. I can also call a function assigned to assign values so that the first n ones are set to the default value, which is 0 for numbers. The first n ones set to some value x, or assign all the values from a range that I give from first to last, so from list begin, for example, to list end, to this container. Here you have to be very careful. The assignment does not change the size of the container. If the container was empty and you do an assign, it just crashes. This requires that you had the container resized to the correct size. There's also another vector-like container called Valeray. Valeray is something that the standards committee added at the very last moment when they realized, hey, Fortran is fast for numerics, but C++ is not, so let's just fix it by making a new fast numerical array class called Valeray. And to make it fast, they dropped the iterators. To make it fast, they don't have a reserve, and to make it fast, they have a resize, but the resize doesn't keep the values around. And they thought that would make it useful. What they did is they created a totally broken class. It didn't make it faster, it just made it broken because this is not a container. It doesn't have iterators, it doesn't really have the right semantics, and it's not very useful. But what they did is they added functions like plus and minus and star and exp and so on. So you can have two Valerays or three and then write down an equation that acts on the whole Valeray. But it's not the fastest library, and there are much better libraries, and they just created something broken. What the standards committee has learned from that is that before you make something a standard, you establish that it's really useful, you try it out as a library, and if many people use it, and it's well-converged and well-tested, then you make it a standard. You don't just invent something on the fly just to solve a problem, and then you, and then your solution is worse than the problem was. So while array might sometimes be useful, but remember, it's a very strange class, and it might not work as you expect it to work. Then for queues and stacks, they don't implement a special queue and a stack class, but queues and stacks are so-called sequence adapters. They use internally a deck or a vector or something to store it, and on top of that, they give you an interface that makes it look like a queue or a stack. And they're called stack queue and priority queue. On the stack, we have a function push to put things on top. We have a function pop to remove something from the top. And we have a function top to look at the topmost element. For the queue that has push, that inserts at the end, the pop removes at the front, and the function front and back to access the first and the last element. And the class is just called queue and stack, and they're templated on the type. And the priority queue by default uses the less than operator to find out who comes first. Lists. The list will be useful because we said we want to use the list for the Panda model. And for the list, there are a few special functions that can be done very, very fast and efficiently for a list, and that's why they are implemented directly as members of the list class. One is a splice function. What does splice do? Splice takes one list, right? We had one list here. Let's assume we have a second list. And now what if I want to splice the list, so I want to put one list to the end of the other? The generic way of doing that is you would copy over the elements and push each element to the back of the first list. This is what you would have to do for a vector. You have to just copy the values over. For the list, it's much easier. For the list, if you want to put this list here at the end of that one, if you want to splice the two, then just need to set one pointer here, and it's done. So that's what the splice does. There's also a sort function, the list that does a sort. When you sort a list, you don't have to move the values around, you just have to relink the pointers so that it's sorted. So that's why there's a sort function. And then there's a merge function. The merge takes two sorted lists. Let's sketch one list here. Let's say we have a list A, points to E, and then N. We have a second one that is B and C and F. Then to merge the list, to make a single sorted list from them, I just go from A, now I relink it to B, C, E, F, N, and so on. And I just change the pointers, and then it's a single sorted list, a single merged list. This is the function merge. Then there's a function remove of a value that removes every entry that has the value x, so all the e's, for example, can be removed, and this will be useful for the Panda model. There's a function remove if. Remove if removes all those for which the function object that you pass as the criterion here returns true. So let's say we want to remove all the negative values from my list of numbers. All right, the function is negative. That returns true if x is less than 0. Then I call the function remove if of my list with this negative argument, the point to the function. This applies this function object here to every element, and those where it returns true get removed. In the Panda model, we want to do that for removing dead animals, for example. remove all animals that are dead, that is single call to remove if with an appropriate function passed in here. Now we get to a bit more complex class, namely the map class, which is the most useful of the three classes. The map class, first to think about how it is implemented. It's implemented as a tree that stores pairs of values, a key and a value. And so the map class takes two values, for example, a string and a long. And here I use it to store a phone book. And then the way I use it just like an array, but where the index need not be an integer, but the index can just be any type, like here a string. So I can write phone book of Troyer is 32589, phone book of Hape is 32591, and so on. And then to use it, I can just look it up by checking is phone book of name defined. If it's not defined, if there's no phone number in there, it just gives you zero. So if it's non-zero, then I write the phone number of that name is, and then I print the number. Otherwise, I print that's unknown. And this implement is a tree of pairs. And the pairs are the value type, are the key type and the map type. The key type is the first one here, the string. The map type is the second one here, the long. And the value type, which is stored in the trees, the pair of the two. And as long as you keep that in mind, the rest is easy. But if you know, but you have to think a bit, because it might be confusing. If you use an iterator to iterate through it, the iterator points to a value type, so it points to a pair. In this case, where there's Hape and Troyer, the first one will be a pair made of Hape and 32591, the second one is Troyer and 32589. So insert, remove, and so on always takes these iterators pointing to those pairs. There's also the multi-map, where I can store more than one phone number per person. And the set, the multi-set, is a simpler tree where it's just the key type and it's all sorted by that type. And how do we find things in such sets and maps? For the map, the simplest way is just using the subscript operator. In a set, how do I find it? Or in a multi-map, how do I find it? One thing is I can call the function a.find of k. That gives me an iterator that points to an element with that key. If there are multiple phone numbers, for me, it will just give you some of them. So what if you want to know how many phone numbers are there for Troyer? You can call a.count of k of Troyer that will count how many entries are there with that key. And now, how do I actually get all of the phone numbers? What you do there is you return iterators. The lower bound function gives you an iterator pointing to the first element with that key. So it points to the first of my phone numbers. The upper bound points to the first entry with a key that is larger than what you passed in. So the lower bound to upper bound is the range of values with the same key. Let's just assume we have a tree, and then I now draw it as a sequence straight out. Let's say we have A, then B, 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 C, D, E, K. And that we store in a tree. And if I call count of B, it gives me 3. Count of F gives me 0. If you call find of B, it points to one of those. If we call lower bound of B, that's lower bound of B. Points to the first one. Upper bound of B points to which one? The third B. It's the iterator point of the first element with the key that's bigger. It points to here. It points to the C. That's the upper bound of B. Remember when we had iterators going through a sequence, begin was the first and end was past the end. So that when I reach that one, then I know I'm done with, I'm over. So here, I can now print all B's by just going from lower bound of B, then increment the iterator until it's equal to the upper bound, and then I stop. What is the lower bound of F? Lower bound of F is an iterator pointing to the first element where the key is larger than or equal F. This is lower bound of F. Right? K is the first key that is larger than or equal F. Upper bound of F is the same. So when it's not in there, then both iterators, lower bound and upper bound, point to the same value, which is the one past it. Is that useful? It's useful because it tells you where would it be if it were there. And if I now use those iterators, lower bound and upper bound, to go through the sequence, with the same way we printed before, I start with the iterator being the lower bound, and I check, is the lower bound equal to the upper bound? If it is, then I stop. So here, check, I start here with the lower bound, but lower bound is the same as the upper bound, so I've stopped and I don't loop through it. If I want both the lower bound and the upper bound, there's a function equal range that gives you just a pair of the lower bound and the upper bound. And it's just faster than calling it twice, because once you find one, it's easy to find the next one. So finding both at once is faster than finding the two separately. So there are these functions. Getting that designed correctly took the standards team and the people who invented it about 20 different attempts until they found out that this is the version that made the most sense. So here's one example of a multimap. I have my phone book, which is now a multimap, and I make some type tests to make it easier. And in my phone book, I now want to insert phone numbers, and because there can be multiple values for the same key, I can't just use the subscript operator, but I use the insert function, phonebook.insert, and then have to pass in the value type. The value type here is a pair of the string and the integer. And I put in the next phone number, the next one, and so on. And then at the end, I want to find out all the phone numbers for Troyer. For that, I called the function equal range, and that returns a pair of iterators, and that was just this type def here of the phone book concentrator. And then I go through it with the standard for loop from first to the second one, because the first entry of the pair is the beginning of the range, the second is the end. So I start the iterator at the lower bound. As long as it's not at the upper bound, I print the number. And what is the number? The number is the map type, and this iterator points to a value type, and the value type is the pair of string and int. That's why I print the second one here. The first would just print the key. Look at that and ask questions next time if it's confusing. Then there are more containers in there. There are C-style arrays that we had. Strings, val array, bit sets, they all have some of the same things that the container has, but not all. The string doesn't have iterators, but it has a size function. C-array doesn't have iterators, but the pointer works like an iterator. Like when I looked at the constructor of the vector that takes two iterators, then I can also pass in two pointers. And use it that I have the array here, 37294, and I want to initialize the vector with those values, and I just say I want to copy the values from x, which is the pointer of the first element, to x plus 5, which is one past the last one, and use those pointers into my C array like an iterator. And now that we have iterators and the containers, now we want to use and write generic algorithms. We want to implement a large number of useful algorithms so that I write it once and then it works for every container. And these are beautiful algorithms and beautiful examples of good generic software design, of good template code. We'll show you some now, and then we'll use them in the Panda model, and then next time we go through many, many details of the algorithms. But to show how it works, let me use the find example. Find is a function with which I should be able to find whether a certain element is in a sequence. And the way I'm implementing it is I implement the find function here, and it gets three arguments. It gets an iterator pointing to the first element in the sequence, an iterator pointing to the last element in the sequence, and the value I'm looking for. And what the function then does, it goes through the sequence using the iterator. If it finds the value, it returns the iterator pointing to the value. If it doesn't find it, it returns the iterator pointing to the to last, so to the end of the sequence once I reach the end. So here's the loop then. While first not equal last, so as long as I'm not at the end of the sequence, and the value of the iterator first is not the value I'm looking for, so as long as I'm not at the end and I'm not at the value I'm looking for, I'm incrementing the iterator. And I repeat this, and I break out of the loop either when I reach the end, and then I return last, or when I find the value, and then I return the iterator pointing to the value. Here's how I use it. I have a list of strings where I store fruits, and then I want to look, is there an apple anywhere in that list? So I call the function find, and it passes the range fruits begin and fruits end, the whole range of the list, and this value I'm looking for, I pass in apple. If the iterator that I get back found here, if that is the end, then I know there was no apple in there, and I print no apple in the list. And if I found it, then I print the value, and it better be an apple. But this, you see, this is a very simple three-line function that implements the find for any container. It works for lists, for tags. It works for vectors, it works for trees, it just finds something. And we could write it in a generic way because we first made the concept of the iterator as a generic way of going through any sequence. There's another one that's a bit more flexible, findIf. FindIf takes a predicate. A predicate is a function object that returns a Boolean. So I want to find any of my favorite fruits, and I might just look for something that is either apple or orange. So I want to find the first one for which a certain function returns true. Here in this case, the function favorite fruits, it's true if the name is apple or orange. Then I call the function findIf with that function pointer to favorite fruits. And if I found it, then I print what I found, and that might be apple or orange. How to implement it? It's again templated on the iterator in here. I call that in because it's an input iterator. The standard writes it out very long as template class input iterator, so that you know you have to pass in an input iterator. And class pred for the predicate, that's this function here. And now the loop is similar to before. I make a while loop, while first not equal last. So I break out when I reach the end, or I break out when the predicate P called on the element is true. So I only go on as long as it's false. So I call the function P, the predicate P, on the value that the iterator points to. And if that is apple or orange, then it returns true. And then I break out of the loop here and return the iterator. But now let's say we want to use that to find a pregnant animal in our list for the panda model. Let's assume we have this list of animals, the population pop here. And now I want to just call find if pop begin to pop end is pregnant. But this is probably doesn't do what you want, because what you probably want is that it calls your member function is pregnant or is dead or something. But this here, if we look at the code, then you see it calls the function p of the argument. So this assumes that what you pass in is a function is pregnant that takes as argument an animal. But I want actually to call that member function pregnant. What can I do? I can just write this function is pregnant of the animal x return x dot pregnant. But that's kind of stupid, because that's it's a one-line function that just calls the member function. And this is useful many times. But I want to call a member function. I can just write the function on this one here that then calls the member function. And because it's so often used, there's a function in the standard called memfunref that takes a function pointer and creates a function object that just calls the member function. So memfunref of a pointer to a member function creates a function object that calls the member function if you call it with the argument. So here we have the find if of pop begin to pop end of is pregnant. That didn't work because that's not what we wanted, but we call it just with memfunref of the animal :: pregnant. That creates a function object that will work when I call it like a function. If I call that function object with animal, it calls the member function. That we might use for removing the dead animals. And the list had the function remove if. Somewhere we had it, remove if. We can use that member function of the list and tell it to just remove all dead animals in a single function call. It gives you a very elegant and short code. Now, pushback. We had pushback, insert something at the end. And now what I want to do is I want to insert 100 elements somewhere. If I take two vectors of int v and w, and I make a loop up to 100, then it's okay if I call 100 times pushback of k and I insert another value k. It is not okay if I just write v of k equal k. Why not? Because the size of v was 0. And I cannot just assign the first 100 elements without changing the size first to 100. So one way of doing that is I can first set the size to 100 by resize and then I sign, or the more elegant version was to use pushback. There's the same problem with the copy. There's a function copy that copies one container from vbegin to v.end to another one that is specified here as wbegin. This will not work well. Why not? V is of size 100, W is of size 0. If you copy it over, it will crash because it didn't allocate memory. One way of solving this is like up here. I could have resized V to size 100. I can here resize the W to 100 and then copy. That's safe, but not elegant. The elegant one is I want to copy it over, but I want to use pushback to insert it. What you do there is you can use the back inserter function from the standard. The back inserter of a container W gives you an iterator, where when you copy into it, it pushes it back to the end of the container. So here the copy from vbegin to vend into the back insert of w takes all of v and inserts it at the back of w. So here now, and the balance I'll do later. So here now, that's the last thing I wanted to show you today, is how could we implement the pendant population. This is not how you have to do it. These are just some ideas of what you might want to do. The majority suggested we should use a list, so let's use a list here. So in the population class, we might store somewhere as a member privately a list of animal L to store the animal, store the population. How can I remove all of the dead animals? We remember the list had a function gen remove if. When I give that a function that returns true for the dead animals, then all the dead ones get removed. So I use remove if here. And the function might have been called isDead. I don't know how you called it. Did you call it dead or isDead or died or what was the choice? I don't care. Let's say it's called isDead. And we want to check that, but it's a member function, so we use the memfunref. But then we also have to remove all the living animals that are not sick with a certain probability depending on the ratio of the population size divided by the maximum one and divided by n zero. You have to be careful if they're integers, that will not work, so make them double. Now we can write the function object here that takes that ratio as in the constructor, and then we use that to remove all of the ones that starve. Then for the children, when we make the children, we might go through the list and I check if the animal is pregnant, then I want to create a new one as a child. And those children, I might want to push back into a new container, because if I stored it, for example, as a vector, and I put in more and more children, then at some point it gets reallocated. I need more memory. The data is now stored elsewhere. And when I resize a vector, the iterators become invalid. So it's safer in this case. So, and I don't want to go to the end, but I've pushed in new children. Now I ask the children if they're pregnant, and so on. So I want to have a new data structure, for example, this vector here of children. I go through my list. If the animal is pregnant, I push the child back into the children container. And then at the end, once I'm done with all, then I copy all the children back into the population using the copy and the back inserter. That's where I want to stop. And other questions? Can you use the microphone? Because I think you have one here. Yeah. Thank you.
Why should it be a problem if we just insert our children at the iterator we are currently on? Because it will insert it before our animal we are currently dealing with.
It, as long as it's a linked list, is not a problem. But if we were to change it later to a vector, or if we had chosen a vector up here instead of a list, then it's a problem. Because if I reach the end of my capacity, I have to allocate new memory elsewhere. Then copy everything over, but the iterator now still points to the old value and not the new one we have copied it to. So when you insert and remove, then you might reallocate your memory. And then the iterators become invalid. So that's why it's better that if you do two things that change the container, do the changes in a separate one and not in the one through which you're currently iterating, or you have to be very careful when you then change data structure. You might realize that using pointers, your code is very likely to crash if you make mistakes, when the pointers become invalid. Iterators are basically also just pointers. And that problem still remains. You can, now of course, make an iterator that is very, very safe, that checks many things for you. But still, you have to know when does the iterator become invalid. And when you reallocate the memory for the vector, then any iterator, any pointer you had to it, just becomes invalid. Okay. Did anybody do the nice trait implementation that I asked for last time? I think one person did it. Anybody else? Who did it? Raise your hands. One, I think then you will have won the prize next week. Unless somebody else still wants to do one and compete. Okay. I think we have a winner, but you will have to present the solution next time.